Hello students, today we are going to discuss property, plant and equipment under US GAAPs. Let's discuss the today's session's expected accomplishments. First of all, we will discuss what is property, plant and equipment. Then we will discuss initial recognition of property, plant and equipment. Then we will discuss depreciation of property, plant and equipment. Then we will discuss carrying value of property, plant and equipment. Then we will discuss a disposal of property, plant and equipment. Then we will discuss impairment of property, plant and equipment. And lastly, we will solve some exam retired questions of CMA USA program. What is property, plant and equipment? PPE are tangible assets. It means tangible assets means they have physical existence, held for the entity for the period of more than one accounting period. It means its useful life is more than 1 year. They are used for the production of goods, supply of goods or services, rental to others, are for administrative purpose. Okay, let's discuss one by one example. If you have one machine which is you are using to manufacture cloths, that is PPE, which is held for production purpose. You have one motorbike which is used to provide the supply of you have fast food chain, supply of your fast food to your customers, that is used for the supply of goods. Rental to others, you have given on a lease your machinery to someone else, or for administrative purpose, you have head office, and for head office you have building, that is the example of for administrative purpose of PPE. What is initial recognition criteria? It is initially recognized at historical cost. It will include all costs. This is the criteria involved in bringing the asset into its working conditions. So to bring the asset into its working condition, all the costs you have incurred will be capitalized. What are the examples? That is purchase price, which is equal to list price minus trade discount. I believe you would be familiar with trade discount. Then it may include, these are other possible examples, cost of site preparation, delivery cost, installation cost, and construction cost. Keep in mind, I'm explaining you this one thing more. Dismantling cost will not be capitalized. Dismantling cost will not be capitalized. For what? As per US GAAPs, this is I am explaining you, because it can be capitalized as per IFRS treatments are. But under US GAAPs, you can capitalize borrowing cost, which we will discuss later on, but its criteria is again different what criteria is specified by IFRS. Depreciation. It is a systematic and rational allocation. Depreciation is a systematic and rational allocation of cost of PPE over its useful life. When it would be systematic and rational allocation? When you are following the matching principle. So lot of depreciation methods are allowed under US GAAPs, but which method you should have to use, who will follow the matching principle. what is matching principle that you must have to record your expenses in the accounting period in which revenues are generated by incurring those expenses. What is the journal entry? No matter what method of depreciation is used, your journal entry would be debit depreciation expense and credit accumulated depreciation. What is accumulated depreciation? It's a valuation account which we will discuss later on. Look, what is accumulated depreciation? Here we are supposed to record the total depreciation which is charged till that date for an asset. So it is a sum of depreciations charged against that asset till that date, till the date of the reporting period. So it is a valuation account. It's not a real account. It is just a valuation account. To value some figure, it is used for that purpose. What are the other informations required to calculate depreciation? First of all, we need estimated useful life, which is life in years. Then we need estimated salvage value. It is also called scrap value or residual. It is the amount which company is expecting to, by selling that asset at the end of the useful life, less if there is any disposal cost for that sale. Then we have depreciable amount, which is calculated cost minus estimated salvage value. Then we have depreciation methods. First one is straight line method. Then we have double declining balance method. Then we have sum of digits method. Then we have units of production method. Then we have group and composite depreciation method. So these first five methods are used for accounting purpose. Then we have modified accelerated cost recovery system method. This is used for tax purpose. So there are two methods, those are allowed for tax purpose. One is modified accelerated cost recovery system, and the second is straight line method. It means, keep in mind, that these two methods are allowed for tax purpose. All other four methods are allowed for accounting purpose as well as straight line method. So straight line method is the only method which is allowed for tax purpose as well as for accounting purpose. But its treatment is, there is a minor modification about the application of straight line method for tax purpose and for accounting purpose, which we will discuss later on. So let's start with our first method, which is straight line method. It is a depreciation method in which, what is the characteristics of this method? In which equal depreciation charged throughout the life of the asset. How depreciation is calculated? It is calculated through depreciable amount times percentage rate or depreciable amount divided by useful life. So same depreciation will be charged every time period. Depreciable amount, as we discussed earlier, is equal to cost minus estimated salvage value or scrap value. Percentage rate is calculated 100 divided by useful life. So percentage rate is calculated by 100 divided by useful life. Then we have example about straight line method. Let's discuss that we have one asset whose original cost is 110,000 and its residual value or scrap value or salvage value is 10. It means depreciable amount is 100,000, cost minus residual value, and useful life is 5 years. So how we will calculate the depreciation? The rate is 20%, which we calculated by using that formula. like 100 divided by 5 equals to 20%. So every year, this time depreciable amount, which is 100,000, which we calculated by subtracting residual figure from original cost. So every year it's 100,000 times 20%. So every year depreciation is equal. Then we have double declining method. What are the characteristics of this method? Under this method, higher depreciation charged in earlier life and lower depreciation is charged in later life of the asset. What rate is used for this? It is the rate which is double to the percentage rate which we have recognized under straight line method. How we will calculate the depreciation? Depreciation is equal to book value, which is also called carrying value. We will discuss later on, but just for the sake of calculation, I am going to elaborate it here. Book value is equal to cost minus accumulated depreciation. So for year one, your cost is a book value, but later on you have charged some depreciation. So total of accumulated depreciation, you will subtract from your cost, then you will calculate your book value times percentage rate, which we will calculate by multiplying the rate which we have calculated in a straight line with 2. Let's discuss the example. Same data is, but we have changed the method. Our cost is 100,000 and residual value is 10,000. Even though if residual value is given in your question, it is irrelevant. It is irrelevant under double declining method. This is the point which you have to consider. Like the residual value figure, even though it would be given to you in your question, would be irrelevant. And your asset's useful life is how much? 5 years. So let's discuss the solution. So first of all, how we calculated this rate, which is 40%. It is equal to 500 divided by 5. To calculate straight line rate, which is 20%, times 2 equals to 40%. So we multiplied it with the book value at start of the accounting period, which is 110,000 for year one, the original cost. So we multiplied it with this, then this 44,000 is your depreciation for next time period. You subtracted this figure from this, like 110,000 minus 44,000 equals to 66,000. Now this is the book value. Then we multiplied this with this and you charge this depreciation. So now you have noticed, once your life is going on, your depreciation is gradually decreasing. So it is higher in earlier life and lower in the later life. And so again, this you subtracted from this, or the other method is you will made the sum of these two, which would be your accumulated depreciation, which is 400,000 and 0, 2, 4, and 1, 90,400. So we subtracted this figure from our original cost, cost minus accumulated depreciation. Then this book value we calculated, 39,600, then we multiplied it with our rate and so on. For every year we have calculated our depreciation. Then next method is sum of digits method. It is a depreciation method in which higher depreciation charge in earlier life and lower depreciation charge in later life of the asset. How to calculate depreciation? Depreciation is calculated by multiplying depreciable amount multiplied by fraction. what is fraction, we will discuss later on. So how depreciation calculated? Depreciable amount multiplied with fraction. Then how sum of digits calculated? This formula we can use, n into n plus 1 whole is divided by 2 whole. This and this whole figure is divided by 2. Where is n is number of years. So n is what? Number of years. Let's assume our life is 3 years. So n is 3 into n again 3 plus 1 and divided by 2. It is 3 plus 1, 4 times 3, 12. 12 divided by 2 is equal to 6. So this is sum of the digits of total numbers, which is 1 plus 2 plus 3 equals to 6, this figure. So keep in mind that even though if you don't remember the sum of digits, years digits formula, you can calculate by adding the sum, digits of the total numbers of useful life. Like here it's 3, so 1 plus 2 plus 3, if it is 4, then 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus 4 and so on. Let's discuss one example. Under sum of digits method, again we have some amendments. In our original cost is now 170,000 and estimated residual value is 20,000. So our depreciable amount is 150,000 and our useful life is 5 years. So how depreciation will be calculated? I discussed with you that it would be depreciation is equal to fraction times depreciable amount. In this question, our depreciable amount is 170,000 minus 20,000 equals to 150,000. Now, fraction for year 1 is the last digit of the total years divided by sum of digits which we have calculated. So last digit, our useful life is 5. So last digit is 5 divided by sum of digits which we have calculated. Under here we will again calculate. Our formula is n into n plus 1 and whole divided by 2. So equals to 5 into 5 plus 1 divided by 2. So 6 times 5, 30 divided by 2 is equal to 15. By other method, we can again calculate 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus 4 plus 5. So 5 plus 4, 9 plus 3, 12 plus 2, 14 plus 1, 15. So, and gradually for every next period, it would be decreased by 1. So for year 2, it is 4. Then for year 3, it is 3. Then for year 4, it is 2. And for year 5, it is 1. So depreciation is equal to depreciable amount, which is 150,000 times this fraction. So it is 50,000 for year 1, 40,000 for year 2, 30,000 for year 3, 40,000 for year 4, and 10,000 for year 5. In this way, we have calculated our depreciation. Now, we are going to discuss units of production method. Under this method, there is no set pattern to charge depreciation. It will depend on number of units produced during the accounting period. So your depreciation charge will be depended on number of units those are produced during the accounting period. How it is calculated? Depreciation is equal to depreciable amount, which we now familiar, cost minus estimated salvage value, multiplied by units produced during the accounting period, divided by total production capacity of the asset. Let's discuss with this example. We have an asset whose original cost is 170,000 and residual value of 20,000. It is being depreciated over 5 years' life. So budgeted production plan 3,000 units year one, 2,000 units in year two, again 2,500 units in year three, 3,500 units in year four, and 4,000 units in year five. So your total units are 3 + 2, 5 + 2,500 + 3,500, 11,000 + 4,000 = 15,000. So your total budgeted capacity is, your production capacity is 15,000. Now, solution is year one, production of units in this time period, 3,000 divided by total. Now this will be multiplied with depreciable amount, which is 150,000 equals to depreciation figure, and so on. So there is no set pattern. It depends upon what, how many units you have produced, you have planned to produce in every accounting period. So here, more units, more depreciation. Here, less units, less depreciation. Here again, more units than this time period, more depreciation, and so on. So this is, there is no set pattern to charge the depreciation under some of, this is error mistake. It is example of what? Units of production method. Units of production method. This is typo error, sorry. Then we have group and composite depreciation. This is a depreciation pattern which is used to charge, to calculate the depreciation for a set of assets. Group depreciation is used for what? When you have similar nature asset. Means you have same class of asset. And composite depreciation is used for dissimilar assets. Those are not for the same class, for different classes you have assets. Over there, depreciation is calculated. You will calculate weighted average useful life and weighted average depreciation rate. Let's assume in our group, we have two assets, asset one and asset two. Asset one useful life is say 10 years and asset two useful life is say 20 years. So weighted average useful life, how we will calculate? 10 plus 20 divided by 2. Equals to 30 divided by 2, 15. So this we will use as a useful life to calculate our depreciation rate. But when we are charging group, we are using group or composite depreciation method, in that case we will not calculate any gain or loss on disposal of group depreciated asset. If we will sell out that asset, then we will not charge any gain or loss on the sale of that asset. Then depreciation for tax purpose. The department which is dealing for the tax in USA, that is called Internal Revenue Services, IRS. It prescribes the method for depreciation for company's tax return, and that is only specific for tax purposes. That is two methods allowed. One is macros and the other is straight line. Straight line we have discussed earlier, but one minor discussion is about straight line. I am going to discuss here. Under straight line, depreciation will be charged. Depreciation is equal to cost divided by useful life. For accounting purpose, it is depreciable amount divided by useful life. Here it would be cost divided by useful life. Now let's discuss what is macros. Macros, modified accelerated cost recovery system, is the most common type of depreciation required in US tax law. The depreciable base for tax purpose is always 100%. It means its cost, no residual values deduction. So it is the cost of the asset and all other costs which you have capitalized. Okay. Over there, half year convention will apply. What is half year convention? There are three possibilities to charge the depreciation. Half year convention, half year depreciation in the year of purchase, and half year depreciation in the year of sale. Full year convention, full depreciation in year of purchase, no depreciation in year of disposal, are proportionate timely apportion according to the number of months you have hold that asset with you. But for macros, it's a half year convention. So how it works? The depreciation rates are provided by IRS through different tables. So these tables will give you the percentage rates you are supposed to calculate your depreciation. There are several tables. Those are prepared by having half year convention. It could be 3 years table, 5 years table, 7 years table, so on. So just what you have to do, you have to multiply the percentages rates will be given to you in macros table with your cost to calculate your depreciation. How this table will be? Let's assume this is 3 years asset with half years convention. Like 1, 2, 3, 4. Year 1 rate, 2 rate, 3 rate, and 4 rate. These are given by the IRS. So you are not supposed to calculate these percentage rates during your exam. Macros method. The amount of depreciation to be taken for each year for an asset with an original cost of 100,000. Its original cost is 100,000. And depreciated over 3 years property using macros. with half year convention, so how depreciation will be calculated. These percentage rates will be given to you. You are just supposed to multiply these figures with your cost. So it will be multiplied with 100,000 to calculate year one depreciation, 100,000 to calculate year two depreciation, and so on. Now, carrying value or book value, it is a value at which PPE is shown in balance sheet at the end of the accounting period. So this is cost minus accumulated depreciation, sum of the depreciations charged till to date, and if there is an impairment loss, so the balancing figure would be your carrying value, which is also called book value. Then we are supposed to discuss something about disposal of PPE. When we are disposing any asset which is under the jurisdiction of PPE, we are supposed to calculate the profit and loss on disposal, and then we will de-recognize that asset and its relevant accumulated depreciation from our statement of financial position, which is also called balance sheet. So what are the two facts we are supposed to do? One is to remove the asset, de-recognize the asset and its cost and its relevant accumulated depreciation, means you are supposed to de-recognize the book value of the asset, and to calculate the gain or loss on disposal. How to calculate gain or loss? This is the minor formula. Compare disposal proceeds with your carrying value, CV, which is also called book value. If it is greater than this, then difference is gain. If it is less than, if disposal proceed is less than CV, then the difference is loss. But how its journal entries will work? First of all, close cost account of asset against disposal account. Keep in mind, disposal account is a nominal account which is calculated, which is prepared to calculate the gain or loss. So entry is disposal account debit, cost account credit. Then close accumulated depreciation account against disposal account, accumulated depreciation debit, disposal account credit. Then record sale proceeds in disposal account. Sale proceeds we will record cash or bank account debit to disposal account credit, or if it is a credit transaction, it could be receivables debit. Then close disposal account against income statement account to calculate gain or loss. If credit side is greater than debit side, the difference is profit. Then entry would be disposal account debit to IS income statement account credit. But if credit side is it would be credit side is greater than debit side. Here again debit side. And if credit side is less than debit side, there is a loss. So entry would be this: income statement debit to disposal account credit. Or we can make a composite entry: cash debit, accumulated depreciation debit, cost credit, and then balancing figure. If credit figure is higher, then the balancing figure would be on debit side, which is loss. And if debit side is greater than credit side, then the balancing figure is a profit, which would be on credit side. So in this way, we can make even though composite entries, or we can make these individual entries. Because you may notice, just once you will think about this, that disposal account is a nominal account, so real accounts entries are journal entries are there in composite entry. Then sometimes you may have involuntarily disposal. So this is a disposal which you don't want, but which is forced disposal due to the legislation. In that case, clean up. The clean up or removal cost, which is called dismantling cost of old asset. Like now the world is too much focusing about environmental protection. So especially the industries like oil and gas industries over there, if you are installing your plants to dig, to find, to explore the oil or natural resources, in that case, once you will erect that plant from that site, you are supposed to make that site good, that nothing was happened over there. So over there, you are supposed to clean up cost, removal of old asset cost. In that case, what you will do, you will add to the book value of the old asset in determining the gain or loss on disposal. But there is a possibility that the cost of what you will do, the removal cost, dismantling cost, you will add in the book value. Let's assume your asset book value is, say, at that time, 50,000, and your cleanup cost is 10,000. You will add this into this. So your total figure would be 60,000. This you will compare with your sale proceeds. Let's assume your sale proceeds are 55,000. So you are having loss of 5,000. In normal circumstances, it would be a profit because you don't have any removal cost. Okay. But there is a possibility that you may have gain because you may have some insurance coverages of removal cost of or cleanup cost. Then there is a possibility that you may dispose the asset through donation. In that case, the fair value of the asset, market price of the asset at that date, will be recognized as donation expense. And then you will calculate the gain and loss by comparing that fair value with the book value of the asset. So how your journal entry will be done, it would be donation expense with the fair value, debit, then loss on donation, it would be always balancing figure. Then credit asset with its book value. Then you will credit gain on disposal. It is again your balancing figure. Let's do with some calculations. Let's assume your asset fair value is 50,000 and book value is 40,000. So your journal entry would be donation expense with 50,000, book value 40,000. Now you have gain of how much? 10,000. It would be the balancing figure. Or let's assume in case two, if your book value is, say, 35,000, in that case, here it would be 35,000, and here it would be 40,000, and here balancing figure would be 5,000 of loss. Then impairment. What is impairment? We are supposed to check the asset for impairment to prevent what? Asset should not be overstated. Asset should not be overstated. To avoid the overstating of the asset, it should have to reflect their fair value. Compare, this is under what? US GAAPs. Undiscounted sum of, this is important, under IAS, IFRS, it is discounted figure, but we will discuss later on. Future cash flows generated through the use or eventual sale of that asset with book value of the asset. If book value is greater than your undiscounted sum of future cash flows, the difference is impairment loss. So you will compare your cash flows either by usage of that asset or by sale of that asset with your book value. If book value is greater than your cash flows figure, the difference is impairment loss. Then that amount will be write down and is reported as loss during that period. How its journal entry will work? Impairment loss debit to accumulated depreciation credit to bring down at that value the book value of the asset, because by this figure your accumulated depreciation will go up. This is treatment under US GAAPs, and again repeating. Then under IFRS, how impairment will deal. Over there, carrying amount is compared with what? With recoverable amount. If carrying amount is greater than recoverable amount, then the difference is impairment loss. Now, what is recoverable amount? Recoverable amount is higher of fair value of the asset less any cost of sale or value in use. This is discounted present value of future cash flows by usage of that asset. So here we are using the discounted figure, but under US GAAPs we are not discounting it. So fair value of the asset minus any cost of sale and value in use, higher of these you will consider as your recoverable amount. Then you will compare it with your carrying value. Let's assume your asset carrying value is 100,000, fair value is 90,000, and value in use is 80,000. So your recoverable amount is higher of these two, which is 90,000. This you will compare with your carrying value. So the difference of 10,000 would be your impairment loss. Now that impairment loss of 10,000 will be charged to the income statement, but exception is there. Like if you have previously positive revaluation, you have previously, which is allowed under IFRS, you have positive revaluation, then you will debit to revaluation reserve under comprehensive income. Otherwise, we will charge as a loss in your income statement. Then revaluation under IFRS. There is a possibility that sometime your fair value would be higher than your carrying value, but under IFRS this treatment is allowed. Then what you will do, you will calculate positive revaluation, and that increase will be go to other comprehensive income and in revaluation surplus as a credit. But if you have previously impairment loss, then you will give credit to other incomes in your income statement. But if you don't have previously any impairment loss, then gain will go to other comprehensive income. Okay, so this was the discussion about PPE under US GAAPs. Now I'm going to discuss some exam required questions. So question number one is, which of the following is not an appropriate basis for measuring the cost of property, plant and equipment? The purchase price, freight cost, and installation cost of a productive asset should be included in cost. Yes, it meets the criteria, which is all the costs those are incurred to bring the asset into its intended use, location, and condition can be capitalized. Then proceeds obtained in process of readying land for its intended purpose, such as from the sale of cleared timber, you should recognize immediately as income. No. Look, under US GAAPs, if you are preparing the site, then if you will clear anything from that site, and you are earning any revenue from that, you will deduct from the amount which you are going to capitalize. This is something additional information for you. Like here, cleared timber. So the sale proceed from the cleared timber will be deducted from the capitalization amount of the land and building, it's irrespective of, instead of it cannot be recognized as income. So this is the answer. But let's discuss the other option. The cost of improvements to equipment incurred after its acquisition should be added to the asset's cost if they increase future service potential. So this is about subsequent expenditure. So listen, the criteria about subsequent expenditure. If you are doing any expense on your asset after its initial recognition, it can be capitalized only and only if it will improve the ability of the asset to generate the benefit for future services potential. So in that case, it will be capitalized. So this is the correct option. Correct statement. It's not a, it's an appropriate base. And then last one, all costs incurred in the construction of the plant building for from excavation to completion should be considered as cost of, yes, it also meets the basic criteria. So option B is the right answer. Next, selected data from statement of financial position on 31st December year 1 and 31st December year 2 is presented below. PPE cost figures given, accumulated depreciation figure given, additional information is equipment was acquired, addition in the second year, and depreciation was expense was 30,000. The carrying amount, cost minus accumulated depreciation, the book value of the PPE which is disposed of in year 2 should have to be calculated. There are four options for that purpose. There are different methods, but the method which I will use, I will make one cost account and I will make one accumulated depreciation account. So cost account opening balance is 295,000. Then equipment acquired during the period is 65,000. Then closing balance carried down is 340,000. So disposal figure is a balancing figure. Let's do the calculation. 295 plus 65 equals to 360 minus 340 equals to 20,000. So this 20,000 is a balancing figure, which is the cost of the asset disposed. Now accumulated depreciation opening is how much? 102 on credit side. Depreciation charge for the period is 30,000 on credit side. Then on debit side, closing figure 119,000. Again, we will calculate the balancing figure. So 132 + 30, 132 - 119. So 13,000 is Belsing figure, which is the accumulated depreciation of asset disposed of. Now CV is equal to cost minus accumulated depreciation. So this is 20,000 minus 13,000 equals to 7,000. Now listen carefully that here it will take more time. This is for your understanding purpose. We can do another trick like we can make only one account, which is book value account or CV account. For that purpose, opening book value is equal to opening PP cost minus accumulated depreciation 295 minus 102 equals to 193. So 193. So 193,000 is opening balance of carrying value, then closing balance 340 plus 340 minus 119 equals to 221. So closing balance is 221,000. Now addition is of 65,000 and expense is of 30,000. So the Belsing figure would be your disposal CV. Now 193 + 65 - 30 - 221 = 7,000. So here you will do the calculation bit earlier to save your time. So our option A is the right answer. So under next question, corporation purchased manufacturing equipment for 100,000 with an estimated useful life of 10 years and a salvage value of 15,000. The second year's depreciation for this equipment used the double declining balance method is now, your method is double declining method. So your total life is 10 years. So first of all, we will calculate the rate, which is 100 divided by 10 equals to 10% for straight line double declining times 2 is equal to 20%. Now for year 1 it is 100,000 because under salvage value double declining we will not subtract salvage value because it is about carrying value times percentage rate. Times 20% equals to 20,000. So this is year 1. We are supposed to calculate year 2. Year 2 carrying value is now 100,000 minus year 1 depreciation 80,000 times 20% equals to 16,000. So this is your answer. They ask you to calculate second year depreciation, which is option C. After that, the type of asset that qualify for interest capitalization, this is something new which we don't have discussed in our session. It is about interest capitalization. I discussed you earlier that there is a possibility that sometime you may capitalize the interest cost which qualify to for capitalization. What is the criteria for that? Under US GAAP, it's different, totally different from the criteria which is under IAS. Over there you have a complete standard which is called IAS 23. What is this criteria? The criteria is interest should be capitalized. Number one, assets constructed are otherwise produced for entity's own use. If you are constructing or producing the asset for your own use, which is even though constructed or produced by someone else, but you are using that over there you can capitalize. Then assets intended for sale or lease that are constructed or produced as discrete project. It means discrete project which takes a substantial time period, like you are manufacturing ship which you are intended to sell or lease. It is product which you are producing which takes a substantial time period. Then certain equity based investments if you have made for those purpose, if you have borrowed the funds over there, the finance amount, the interest cost, you can capitalize, but with following further criteria. An asset constructed for entity's own use qualifies for capitalization of interest only if relevant expenditure have been made and activity necessary to prepare the asset for its intended use are in progress and interest is being incurred. If these three conditions will met, then you will capitalize. The investee must have activities in progress necessary to commence its planned principal operations and are expending funds to obtain qualifying assets. So if you have incurred relevant expenditure, your production is in progress and you have charged interest, then you can capitalize. Now under this criteria, let's look on the option. Asset that are being used in earning activities of the reporting entity? No. Asset that are ready for their intended use in the activities of reporting entity? The assets that are constructed for the reporting entity own use. So this meet the criteria. So our option is C. But the inventories that are manufactured in large quantity on continuous basis, no. Inventory which is a discrete project, you can make for that. So option C is the right answer. Thank you very much, guys, for your time. I believe you may have enjoyed my lecture on this very critical and important topic, which is examinable for CMA USA exams as well as for CPA USA exams. Thank you very much for your precious time. I hope you may have enjoyed my lecture. Kindly subscribe my YouTube channel and press bell icon to get the notifications of my latest videos. Thank you very much.